फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक। माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव 28th of July 2021। एज यू नो दैट दीज क्लासेस आर यूजफुल फॉर दोज हु आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन विच इज कंडक्टेड बाय द यूपीएससी एज वेल एज अदर गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशंस। एंड एज यू नो दैट वी आर रेफरिंग द टू नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स, द हिंदू एंड इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। फॉर दिस पर्पज यू कैन ऑल्सो start reading these two national newspapers, which are most important for the civil services examination preparation, and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first lecture is all about the Dholavira inscribed in the World Heritage List. So recently, the Dholavira, who is also a Harappan era metropolis, right, or Harappan city, which have been located in the Gujarat, have been inscribed on the UNESCO's World Heritage List, right? This has been informed by the UNESCO on 27th July 2021, right? There is already an ongoing 44th session of the World Heritage Committee of the UNESCO, right, which have already, inscribed, or which have already given, right, the title for the World Heritage Site to the Rudreshwara Temple or the Ramappa Temple. That news you would have seen in the previous few days. The Ramappa Temple in Telangana was also given the UNESCO's World Heritage status, right? And after Ramappa Temple, the Dholavira, which is in Harappan site, was also been accorded to the World Heritage Site status, right? This importance or this inscription of this World Heritage status on the Dholavira would have great importance for Gujarat as well as for entire country. So this session of the World Heritage Committee is chaired by, chaired from the Fuzon specifically, right? The World Heritage Committee will basically meet in the China. That is being held online, right? There was no such, the physical sitting on the sitting, and that session was started on the July 16th and that ended on July 31st. Okay. And as you know that Dholavira is now the 40th treasure or 40th site in India to be given the UNESCO's World Heritage inscription. So the Gujarat has so far three World Heritage sites. So Gujarat has the three World Heritage sites with them, right? What is that? The first is basically the Champaner. The Champaner near the Pavagadh, that is the first UNESCO's World Heritage site. The second is basically the Rani Ki Vav. The Rani Ki Vav, that is located in Patan, and the third is basically the historic city of Ahmedabad. Okay, that is the third site. Now that Dholavira would be the fourth site for that purpose, right? As you know that the session for the World Heritage Committee was held in the Fuzon, that was held in the online mode, and this was 44th session, which combined the current work as well as the issues which are left for outstanding since last year because of COVID-19 pandemic, right? And because of that, the many times, the COVID, because of this committee, which is also known as World Heritage Committee's meeting, was basically postponed, right? And as you know that it has entered into the Super 40 Club for the World Heritage Site inscriptions, which are also informed by the Ministry of Culture. Okay. And since 2014, India has added 10 new World Heritage Sites, and that has also enhanced the prestige of India in the World Heritage List. Alright, so let's begin with the new news. That is, the government introduces a bill to amend the insolvency law. So recently the government have introduced a bill in the Lok Sabha to amend the insolvency law and provide some sort of a pre-packaged resolution process for the stressed micro, small and medium enterprises, that is called MSMEs. So this proposed amendment, right, that have been recently been made by the government would enable the government to notify, first of all, the threshold of the default, right, which are not exceeding ₹1 crore. So that Nirmala Sitharaman have incorporated the insolvency in the Bankruptcy Code Amendment Bill 2021, right, specifically, right, would replace the ordinance. That ordinance was basically promulgated by the President on the 4th of April 2021. So this promulgation of ordinance necessitated, right, that ordinance would either lapse because it has some time period for its life, or otherwise it may, you know, replaced by another ordinance, or it may also replaced by, you know, the bill that is in the form of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Amendment Bill 2021. Okay. The government has proposed this amendment that would enable the government to notify the threshold of the default that is not exceeding 1 crore rupees for the initiation of the resolution process for the pre-packaged, right? So here, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code Bill 2021, which was one of the important aspect which was recently been amended. So under this pre-packaged resolution process, what is that? So under this pre-packaged process, that the main stakeholders, like you have the creditors, the shareholders, okay, come together, right, to identify the prospective buyers, and they both will negotiate a resolution plan before approaching to the National Company Law Tribunal, right, for that purpose, right. So all resolution plans under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code need to be approved by the National Company Law Tribunal as per the code. So what would be there in the pre-practice process? The creditors and the shareholders would come together to identify the prospective buyers, and they will negotiate this resolution plan, and then they will approach to the National Company Law Tribunal for their approval. So here, as per the statements of the object and the reasons of the bill, right, it basically seeks to specify the minimum threshold, which is not more than 1 crore rupees, right, for initiating the pre-packaged, basically insolvency resolution process, right, as well as the provisions for the disposal of the simultaneous applications for the initiation of the insolvency resolution process, right. So here, which is basically very important for resolving any sort of insolvency process. Now, there will also be penalty for the fraudulent or for malicious initiations, right, of such pre-packaged insolvency resolution process, right, and there is also provision for the penalty for the default persons, for the fraudulent, for the management of the corporate debtors during the entire process. So that code that we call Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, that came into the force in 2016, as you know that, right, it was promulgated by the Ministry of Finance. And it was enacted, right, to consolidate as well as to amend the laws related to the reorganization and the insolvency resolutions of the corporate persons, partnership firms, and the individuals for that purpose. All right. Next, you have the Assam-Mizoram border issue. So recently, right, both Assam and the Mizoram, both are the northeastern states, have had to had the fight for the border issues. So this fight is not a new, it is a decades old Assam-Mizoram border dispute, but it recently turned the ugly, right, as the firing between the polices, right, the Assam police and the Mizoram police, and ultimately the 6 Assam cops were basically killed in that firing, and several more cops were basically injured in that firing from the Mizoram police. So the border has long been a dispute, long been a contention for the dispute between the two northeastern states, and there was multiple talks even before also that was facilitated by the center way back in 1995, right, as was a recent talk that was on the 9th July 2021, right, this year made remains inconclusive. So and after that the situation remains worsened, and there was firing. So what happens is the firing, which was preceded by the incidence of bombing, there was the incidence of the bombing and the encroachment, right, on either side of the borders. The Mizoram says that Assam police have bombed us, the Assam police have encroached our land. Then Assam police also put the same allegations on the Mizoram. So during the 9th July talk, right, the Mizoram miscreant basically said to have conducted some sort of a IED explosion, right, that was done in the Assam's Kutch district, that is located in Assam, right, targeting the delegation of the Assam government officials. For that purpose, that was that IED explosive device was put by the Mizo miscreant, and which is targeting that delegation, including the senior police officers who were basically on the visit to oversee the construction of the road along the border. But there was no casualty that was reported. Okay. This was in the retaliation with two back-to-back explosions on the either side of the border. That was basically on 10th July, the next day of the meeting that was held. Right? Even the Mizoram Home Minister was also alleging that the crops of the Mizo farmers were destroyed by the Assam police personnel, and the Assam police personnel have intruded into their territory. So that definitely, the Mizoram Home Minister was demanding that compensation to the affected farmers should be given by the Assam. So there is three districts specifically, that is basically in the southern Assam, Barak Valley, that is the Karimganj, that is Hilakandi and Kachar, that shares almost 123 kilometers long border with the Mizoram district, that is Mamit, Kolasib and Ozol districts. Okay, now the border dispute between two states is a long-standing issue, as you know that it's a decade-old issue. And Assam says that the boundary which was demarcated in basically 1933 resolution would be maintained, right? And what the Mizoram insists that the same has drawn in the Bengal, Eastern Frontier Regulation. Right, Eastern Frontier Regulation, which was passed in 1875 during British time, should be actually boundary. So Mizoram was insisting on this Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation 1875, and the Assam was basically insisting on the boundary which was demarcated in 1933, notification. Definitely, this was a bone of contention since the decade and was not resolved. And the violence basically broke even last year also. Even the February this year also, right, where some schools were allegedly bombed by the miscreants from the Mizoram side, specifically in the Assam, right? And the Mizoram, on the other hand, they claim that the schools were basically set up by the Assam officials on their land, right, for that purpose. And there was a lot of issues also between Assam and Mizoram for that purpose. Alright, so let's begin to the new news that is related to the bagging. So recently, Supreme Court on 27 July 2021 has said that the begging is basically a socio-economic problem. It is a socio-economic problem. The beggars are having no option than to beg on the roads, right? So the Supreme Court basically held that it cannot ban the begging altogether because otherwise it will take an elitist view, as the beggars are forced to take on the streets, right? They are out of compulsion to come on the streets to basically beg due to the lack of education, due to the lack of employment facilities, due to the lack of other facilities that has basically not been given sincerely by the government of India as well as other state governments. So it's a socio-economic problem rather than considered them as a entirely new problem. So it cannot take the elitist view on the begging. So here, a bench of justice, D.Y. Chandrachud as well as M.R. Shah basically issued that notification to the center as well as to the Delhi government on the petition which was filed by the basically advocate Kush Kalra, right, which was seeking to the vaccination of these beggars, right, as well as a rehabilitation of those beggars which are lying on the roads, specifically in the Delhi NCR region, right? As you know that because of COVID-19 pandemic, the beggars have lot of issues, they have lot of concerns, right, with respect to the vaccination, rehabilitation, the food and other shelter related aspects. Okay, so the reason why the people are required to take the streets is to beg out, to ease out some sort of elementary livelihood in the absence of education and employment facilities. So the Supreme Court says that it is a socio-economic problem. It is a socio-economic problem and cannot be remediated in this way. Right, and referring to that plea by the petitioner to restrain the people from begging on the streets, right, the bench basically asked him or the petitioner, why do the people beg on the street, right? It's due to the poverty, it's due to the absence of education, due to the absence of employment facilities, it's a socio-economic problem, right? And we cannot take the elitist view, they have no choice, they are out of compulsion, right, for doing that type of practices. So it's a wider issue, of the social welfare policy, right? So it's a wider issue of social welfare policy which have not been sincerely implemented or made for that purpose. And the court said that the beggar bonds or homeless were entitled to give the medical facilities, right, as they were also vulnerable in the context of the COVID-19 the pandemic that has been engulfed the entire country, right? And they are the most vulnerable segments of the people of the society for getting that type of facilities. Next, you have the typhoon in FA. So recently, the typhoon in FA has moved to the Shanghai, right? It's a basically, it's a tropical storm which have been named as the typhoon in FA that have been moved to the Shanghai and continue to lash the city. The Shanghai is the city in China after making the landfall at the nearby island city of the Zhongshan. Okay, so the typhoon in FA is basically a severe tropical storm, right, which is also known as the tropical storm Fabian in the Philippines. So it is a similar storm, right, that was basically, you know, originated specifically from the Philippines ocean or from the Philippine sea, right, and it has basically reached to the basically Shanghai and it's causing the devastation specifically in that region. So it is also known as the Fabian in, right, it is been named recently as Infa. Okay, so basically the similar severe tropical cyclone. Now the storm Infa, officially the seventh tropical storm specifically in 2021 Pacific typhoon season, and it will be the third typhoon after category 5, the Suregei, which was basically originated in mid-April, right, in the similar region, as well as the category 1 typhoon, which was originated in the late June, that was named as Champi. So, right, the two cyclones or the severe storms have already been occurred. The first was occurred in the mid-April and the second was occurred in the June, that was named as Champi. Okay, now let us understand a brief discussion about the tropical storms. So, the tropical storms, in the definition or the ambit of the tropical storms, the hurricanes, cyclones, typhoons, they are all, you know, the different types of or different categories of the tropical cyclones. But they have given the different names, right, on where they basically appear. Right, for example, right, the hurricanes are basically the tropical cyclone that form over the northern Atlantic Ocean, as well as in the Northeast Pacific, right? The cyclone specifically are formed in the South Pacific as well as, you know, the Indian Ocean. It is also formed in the Indian Ocean region, right? Similarly, the typhoon, which is formed over the Northwest Pacific Ocean. So they have been named wherever they are basically formed. Now in terms of the Saffir-Simpson, you know, the typhoon wind speed, for example, they have been also categorized in the category 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? That is based on the wind speed that occurs in those tropical cyclones. Now, some of the favorable conditions for the tropical cyclones, for example, you know, they need at least, you know, the sea surface temperature should be greater than 27 degrees Celsius wherever they occur, right? There is also presence of the Coriolis force, right? That is a virtual force that occurs due to the, you know, due to the rotation of the earth to create some sort of a cyclonic vortex. Then there should be a small variations in the vertical wind speed, right? So these are some of the preconditions, as well as you need the pre-existing weak low pressure area specifically in that zone. The most important is the sea surface temperature should be more than or should be higher than 27 degrees Celsius for that purpose. Now, what has fueled this Infa storm, which is also tropical storm? So, as you know, that favorable condition for basically these tropical cyclones over the Pacific basin have led to the birth of this tropical storm specifically in the Philippine Sea. The sea surface temperature across the Western Pacific Ocean specifically are extremely warm, which is more than 27 degrees Celsius, even hotter in that some places in the summer. So, large portion of this Pacific Ocean or the Pacific Sea, as well as the South China Sea, is very, very hot, where the sea surface temperature reaches to around 30 degrees Celsius, right, as well as 32 degrees Celsius. So the temperature of the Philippine Sea as well as the South China Sea have reached to 30 to 32 degrees Celsius, and this is extremely supportive for the healthy fuel of these deep convecting storms, right, and this has led to ultimately the tropical storm that is also known as Infa. Okay, now let us understand how these tropical storms are basically formed. So here, first of all, I told you that there should be some sort of a favorable conditions, like temperature should be more than 27 degrees Celsius. There should be presence of the Coriolis force, right? For that purpose, there should be small variations in the vertical wind speed, and there is also the pre-existing, you know, weak low pressure area over there, right? So all such conditions should be there in order to form this tropical cyclone. So how these tropical cyclones are formed? So you need basically high humidity and the ocean temperature that is over 26 degrees Celsius for the major contributing factors. So the water basically evaporates from the oceanic surface, that comes into contact with the mass of the cold air that is basically forming ultimately the cloud, and the column of the low pressure basically develops at the center. The wind started forming around that column, that started basically spiraling around that column, and the pressure specifically in the central column that basically weakens, and the speed of the winds around that particular column has increased. So you can see the middle portion is basically also called the eye of the storm. It's a very high, it's a high pressure zone, right? From there, if you move out, there will be high speed winds that is basically, you know, increases in that respect. Okay. Next, you have the National Research Foundation. The National Research Foundation. So recently, the Union Education Minister, Mr. Dharmendra Pradhan, has said that the government proposes to set up this National Research Foundation. Right. The main purpose of setting up of this National Research Foundation is to strengthen the research ecosystems in our country. Right. So this National Research Foundation is being emphasized as an umbrella structure that would definitely improve the linkages between the research and the development, as well as the academia and industry. So nowadays, what is happening is that this research and the development is some sort of a, is not related or is not assimilated with the industry. So industry is specific, right, that will cater the needs of the industry, right? For that purpose, the research and the development should be interlinked with the academia and industry for that purpose, right? And there is also the total proposed outlay for this National Research Foundation is around 50,000 crore rupees. 50,000 crore rupees have been proposed over the period of 5 years, right, as per the Union Education Minister, Mr. Dharmendra Pradhan, has informed. And one of the main objective of this National Research Foundation is basically to seed, to grow and to facilitate the research at the academic institutions, right, as well as to link that academic institutions with the industry so that it can cater, right, the growing need of the industries, which are basically at the nascent stage. Even the research capacities of various universities are at the nascent stage. So there will be two-way development, right? One side, the research capacity of the universities will be enhanced, and the second side, there will be also linkages between the university and industry, so that it could be industry specific research and the development that could facilitate the industrial development also in that context. Okay. Next, the Chaurasi Course Parikrama Marg. So recently the central government last week have decided to declare the 84 course Parikrama Marg around the Ayodhya as a national highway. So here, the Road Transport and the Highway Ministry have issued the draft notification that has declared this Chaurasi Kosi Parikrama Marg as a national highway specifically in the state of Uttar Pradesh. So all three parikramas in the Ayodhya, that is the 50 km long, then 42 km long, and that is approximately, you know, that is linked to the Lord Rama. So the Bal Kand, which is of the Balmiki Ramayana, mentioned the Ayodhya was earlier known as, you know, the Kaushala Desh or the Kaushal Desh, which was initially spread to around 48 cores, right? And that was later exposed to around 84 cores. So the Bal Kand of Balmiki Ramayana had mentioned this Ayodhya, and this 84 cores parikrama is basically, you know, circumambulation of the Kaushala Desh, which was also the second name for this Ayodhya, touching all important places which were associated with the kingdom of Ram. So here the 14 course parikrama is of main Ayodhya city at that main Ayodhya city, right, of that time, and 5 course parikrama is basically circumambulate the inner circle within the heart of the Lord kingdom where it is located. So there is the 15, 42 and 275 kilometers parikrama that are linked to the Lord Rama for that purpose. Next, you have the Kashesh, the first green industrial city. So here, the Gujarat's Kandla Special Economic Zone, which have become the first green industrial city in our country. So Kashesh, which is currently around 1,000 acres, the land has around 3.5 lakh trees, right? And recently it has been declared as a first green industrial city. So Kashesh right, where, you know, the plantation activities, where the trees have been planted in the post 2019 using the Miyawaki forestation method. So this Miyawaki forestation method have led to the growing of the forest, specifically of the growing of the trees, specifically in the Kazakhs special industrial zone. So Kazakhs basically is an oldest export zone in our country, which have received the platinum rating also under the IGBC green rating cities, right, in specifically in the industrial city category. So the planting of the trees, you know, specifically, you know, halted the growth of the salt pan, right, beyond the Kandla, and that is also helped in the reduction of the salinity and also improved the quality of the top soils as informed by the government. So to prevent the salinity of the land, right, as well as which is to be coming, you know, in the contact with the planted trees, the torn cloths were basically placed in the land as per as the first layer before the seeding of the trees. So after seeding of these trees, the part of the plantation is surrounded by the torn cloths, which ensure the maximum water retention in that area. So the Kazakhs was also used as a Kazakhs was also used, you know, the plastic waste to line the artificial water bodies that is created inside the area to prevent the water seepage, right? Specifically, the mix with the saline water for that purpose. Okay, and the SEZ or Special Economic Zone initiative with the solar energy and LED lighting was also among the factors that has contributing to this rating that was given to the given to this Kazakhs the Special Economic Zone. So let us understand what is about the Miyawaki method. The Miyawaki method has been named after Japanese botanist, that is Akira Miyawaki. Akira Miyawaki, who has basically invented this method. So it involved the planting of the several species very close together in a small pit. So these plants basically draw the nutrients from each other and become healthy. A dense forest which grows naturally in 300 years is created in just 30 to 35 years. So the trees grows 10 times faster and absorb 30 times more carbon dioxide, and also the density is 30 times that of the normal tree plantation, right? So definitely is of greater use, right? And this Miyawaki method is of, you know, greater importance for India for the purpose of other afforestation program. Okay, next you have the gross environmental product. So here the Uttarakhand will initiate the valuation of its natural resources, right, in the form of the gross environmental product on the lines of the gross domestic product. So here, as you know that the environment provided lot of ecosystem services. This ecosystem services was initially formed in 1981 to attract the academics towards this aspect, right? So these ecosystem services that are benefit the human population, that are derived, you know, the benefit directly or indirectly from ecosystem function. For example, what type of ecosystem services that we are talking, right? Specifically, you can say there are many types of ecosystem services that have been provided, right? For example, that have been benefited the humans, like the forest lakes, grasslands, the timbers, right, the dyes, the carbon sequestration, nutrient recycling, soil formation, productivity, the tourism, right? So there are different types of ecosystem services. For example, you can say that the provisioning services like drinking water, the oil and natural gas, right? Then you have the regulating services, right, like climate regulation, the decomposition, water purification. Then you have, you know, the supporting services like nutrient recycling, photosynthesis, soil creation. Then you have ultimately the cultural services, that is recreation, as well as the creative inspiration, the tourism, etc. is also services which have been provided by the ecosystem. Okay, so there are the four key factors for for this green environmental product or gross environmental product. The first is air, that is also known as vayu, that has the sound and touch. The second is forest, that forest has also sound, touch and visibility, that has also smell and the taste for the purpose. The third is water, the water has the sound, touch and visibility and the taste. The soil has the sound, touch, visibility, taste and smell for the purpose. These are the four factors for calculating the gross environmental product. Okay. It has also given the Himalayan context. As you know that Himalayan contribute substantially to the sustainability of the Gangetic Plains, where almost 500 million people live. So according to the recommendation of the 12th as well as the 13th Finance Commission, the grants were transferred to the forest rich states. This is basically amounting to corresponding to their forest cover. So ecosystem services represents lot of benefits. So a system to valorize this ecosystem services in the Himalayan states of India is the way that is consistent with the national mission of the Himalayan ecosystem, right? And this this basically the gross environmental product that we are talking specifically, right, that would have lot of examples. So for example, you have the water recreation, the flood mitigation, the soil recreation, right, soil retention. Then you have the sandstorm prevention, you have sandstorm prevention, pollination, lot of other benefits also it has been provided. Next, you have the Central South Asia Connectivity Conference 2021. So recently Uzbekistan hosted the high level international conference that has been recently been named as a Central South Asia Regional Connectivity Challenges and Opportunity at Tashkent. So this is the name of this conference, which is the Regional Connectivity Challenges and Opportunity, specifically in the Central and South Asia. Okay, it was attended by the presidents of Afghanistan, right, the ministers of the Central Asian countries, the West Asian countries, the South Asian countries, including our External Affairs Minister, right, Mr. Jaishankar. Right, and the delegates over 40 countries and 30 international organizations as well as various think tanks participated in this conference. So as you know that India's priority specifically in this five central countries are of very high. For example, you have the Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, right, then you have the Kazakhstan. So India has lot of important aspects related to that. And Central Asian connectivity is of utmost importance for India, specifically the Iranian port of Chabahar, which has the potential to shift some of the regional dynamics in the India's favor. So the double landlocked Uzbekistan have been interested in using this port to expand trade and the transit options. Right. So Uzbekistan has already developed the rail connectivity to Afghanistan as a means to link with the Iranian railway lines, reflect the Tashkent consciousness. Other Central Asian states like Kazakhstan is also interested in exploring such options. So, given the geostrategic locations of the Central Asia, the region is of also witnessing the fair share of the great power competition, right? And the region is also viewed as the Russia's immediate backyard. The Moscow has already traditionally maintained the dominant role specifically with the Central Asia, and China is rapidly strengthening its footprint. And India is also, you know, pursuing both the geopolitical and economic ties with that region. Okay, what the Chabahar port can offer? The Chabahar is a potential shift that come in the for the regional dynamics, specifically in India's favor. So first of all, it could pave the way for the gateway to the Central Asia as well as for the Eurasia, and it is seen as an effort to exploring the alternate options for, you know, for basically for the Central Asia to the China's Belt and the Road Initiative in that matters. And India has taken a lot of other measures to improve the ties. So India has made the consistent effort specifically to establish the linkages with the region to consider Central Asia as a part of the India's extended neighborhood. But definitely, the lack of the physical connectivity has proven to be the major hurdle specifically in the trade and economic ties. And Modi had become the first Indian leader to have traveled all five Central Asian republic, right? For example, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan in 2015, right? And it has India and Central Asia has also both, you know, have the energy security cooperation also in that respect. All right. Next, the natural gas. So recently, the Petroleum and Natural Gas Regulatory Board has authorized approximately 33,764 kilometer long the natural gas pipeline network across the country with the aim to create the national gas grid as well as to increase the availability of the natural gas across the country. So various steps have been taken to promote the clean gas or the natural gas. First of all, the development of the city gas distribution network, so which supports basically availability and accessibility of the natural gas in the form of the piped natural gas to the households, the industrial use, the compressed natural gas for the transportation purpose. Then this basically, you know, the Petroleum and Natural Gas Regulatory Board was also, you know, has granted the authorization to the Indian Gas Exchange Limited, right, to set up and to operate these gas exchanges for that purpose. As well as it has also allowed any entity to establish and operate these LNG stations, right, in anywhere else in the country for dispensing the LNG in the liquid state only for the transportation sector, right. Let us understand about this institution. So the PNGRB is basically established in 2006 under the Petroleum Natural Gas Regulatory Board 2006. Its ultimate mandate is to regulate the refining, transport and marketing of the petroleum products. It will also ensure that the enough supply across the country, that will also foster the fair trade, protect the consumer interest, authorize the companies that will build and operate this fuel pipelines. So this PNGRB basically consisting of the chairperson, right, as well as the members, right, one member from the legal side as well as three other members, and it will also have the power of the civil court, right, and the bench basically comprises the member of the legal as well as one or more members which are nominated by the chairperson, which basically decides any dispute arising among the downstream companies or with the outsiders with respect to the supply of this natural gas in India. Alright, so that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet again tomorrow for the next interface. Thank you.